Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today, you will hear reports from Jill Robbins and John Russell. Andrew Smith presents this week's education report. We close the show with the lesson of the day. But first, Jill Robbins has this story about what some people are calling the wedding of the year.
Mukesh Ambani is known as the richest person in Asia. This week, his son is getting married. But the celebrations and parties began several months ago. In March, Ambani threw a 3-day party before his son's wedding. The 1,200 guests included former world leaders, tech leaders, Bollywood movie stars, and even the singer Rihanna. In May, the family took guests on a 3-day cruise from Italy to France. Well-known entertainers appeared on the cruise. The main wedding will take place on July 12th. Many observers have described it as the wedding of the year. The groom is 29-year-old Anant Ambani. He will marry his longtime girlfriend, Radhika Marchand. Mukesh Ambani is 66 years old. Forbes magazine says he is currently the world's 9th richest man. The magazine reports he has a net worth of $116 billion. He is considered the richest person in Asia. Ambani's business, Reliance Industries, combines several different businesses, from petrochemicals to telecoms. The Ambani family also owns a huge private apartment building in Mumbai, India. The building is worth $1 billion. Ambani's critics say his company has done well mainly because of political connections to the Indian government in the 1970s and 1980s. It has also had good relations with Prime Minister Narendra Modi's government. The elder Ambani has started passing the business on to his 2 sons and daughter. The oldest son, Akash Ambani, is now chairperson of Reliance Jio, their telecoms business. Isha Ambani, the daughter, oversees the retail business. The groom, Anant, has become involved in the new energy business. Anant studied at Brown University in Rhode Island. He is managing the expansion of renewable and green energy interests for his family's business. He also runs a large animal rescue center called Vantara in Gujarat state. The bride, Radhika Marchand, is the daughter of pharmaceutical business leader Viren Marchand. She directs marketing for her father's company, Encore Healthcare. Radhika told Vogue magazine that she met Anant through friends in 2017. That first meeting just sparked something special between us, and it wasn't long before we started dating, she said. The main wedding ceremony is set for July 12th, followed by a grand reception on July 14th. There will be celebrations at both Ambani's Jio World Convention Center in Mumbai City, and at their family home. The family chose the dates using the Hindu custom for deciding lucky days. Last week, videos appeared on Indian social media showing the couple's Sangeet. That is a ceremony where the bride and groom's families perform dances for the guests. It included performances by Bollywood stars and pop singer Justin Bieber, who flew to Mumbai for the event. The family also organized a mass wedding for for more than 50 needy couples last week as part of the pre-wedding celebrations. I'm Jill Robbins.
Scientists have identified a kind of desert moss that could help support possible colonies on Mars. A study by the Chinese Academy of Sciences showed recently. The moss, Centricia caninervis, was able to survive Mars-like conditions of extreme dryness, very low temperatures, and radiation. The research shows. The study appeared recently in the publication The Innovation. The moss could serve as the basis for the establishment and maintenance of the ecosystem by contributing to oxygen production, carbon sequestration, and soil fertility, the study said. The paper added, it can help drive the atmospheric, geological, and ecological processes required for other higher plants and animals, while helping to create new environments that could support long-term human settlement. The study shows that the moss could return quickly to health even after losing more than 98% of its cellular water. The plant was able to recover its normal operation seconds after getting water. The plant can also survive very low temperatures. It can recover or regenerate after being stored in a freezer at minus 80 degrees Celsius for 5 years. It can survive a month in liquid nitrogen, the researchers found. Researchers collected the study plants from a desert in the Xinjiang Uyghur Autonomous Region of China. The moss also grows in Tibet, the American state of California, the Middle East, and polar areas. China and the United States have announced a number of space exploration plans in recent years. Chinese missions include launching a near-Earth asteroid probe, Tianwen-2, next year, and Tianwen-3 around 2030 to collect material from Mars and bring it to Earth for study. Last month, a Chinese mission collected materials from the far side of the moon. The American space agency NASA has developed a 20-year plan for Mars exploration. It is investigating whether the red planet could support human population. I'm John Russell.
The number of Americans studying in China has decreased by large amounts in recent years, from around 11,000 in 2019 to 800 this year. Some people with knowledge of China worry that the U.S. could lose a generation of China experts as a result. David Moser is an American who has lived and worked in China for more than 30 years. He is the former academic director of China Educational Tours, or CET, in Beijing. He said, "I haven't seen an American student in years." CET was launched in 1982. The organization helps bring American students to China for language and cultural studies. It used to have programs in several cities in China, including Beijing, Shanghai, Harbin, and Hangzhou. Now, the program is only available in Beijing and Shanghai. Moser thinks the U.S. has already lost a generation of students who could be Chinese experts 10 years from now. During the 2011-2012 school year, the number of American students in China was around 15,000. Since then, under Xi Jinping's leadership and growing tension between the two countries, the number has decreased. At one point after the pandemic, the number dropped to 200 students. Moser said having fewer people who understand China is a huge loss for the U.S. You really need people who understand the two academic systems, the two college systems, and the way these things work in order to not make a huge mistake, he said. Compared with China, however, CET's projects in Taiwan have been attracting students. Moser said CET started its first summer study abroad program at National Taiwan University in 2022. The program brought in more than 120 American students. He said the program was set up in Taiwan because too few American students wanted to go to China. Moser believes that starting around 2008, air pollution and reports of human rights violations in China began to turn some American students away. China's strict lockdown during the COVID-19 pandemic also had a large effect. At that time, many foreigners, including American students, left China. In addition, a revised Chinese anti-spying law that took effect on July 1, 2023, has made some Americans worry about traveling to China. The law expands how the Chinese government can look into the activities of foreigners in China. As the law negatively affected China, the Chinese government tried to build up exchange programs. In November 2023, President Xi offered to invite 50,000 Americans to China for exchanges and studies for the next 5 years. Megan Burke is a former sociology professor at Illinois Wesleyan University. When VOA asked her about the 800 American students in China today, she said that the low number was a problem for the United States. Language is key to understanding culture. So, any limits on learning Mandarin or other Chinese languages only hold back our ability to have a broader and more complex intercultural understanding, Burke said. In contrast, 300,000 Chinese students are studying in the U.S. Moser of CET said the unequal number of students between the two countries is bad for both countries. However, he added that it is even worse for the U.S. Moser said, while the U.S. lacks knowledge of China, The Chinese have very good knowledge of the U.S., of its culture, of its government, everything. I'm Andrew Smith.
Andrew Smith joins me now to talk more about this week's education report. Hi, Andrew. Thanks for being here.
Hi, Ashley. It's my pleasure to be here.
Your report centered on the drop in the number of American students studying in China. Can you tell us what experts say are some of the reasons for this decline?
According to David Moser of China Educational Tours, the decline may have started after about the year 2008. That year, China's capital, Beijing, hosted the Summer Olympic Games. At that time, air pollution in Chinese cities became an issue that more people in the U.S. started hearing about. Moser also thinks Americans started hearing more reports about human rights abuses in China. And then the COVID-19 pandemic caused a huge drop in the number of students. Since that time, political relations between China and the U.S. have also had a negative effect on the number of Americans choosing to study in China.
I was also wondering if you could explain one of the words we heard near the end of the report, intercultural. What does intercultural mean, and why is it important?
In English, the prefix inter, spelled I-N-T-E-R, means between or among. So intercultural is an adjective that refers to relations or interactions among two or more cultures. We can say a person with intercultural skill is able to understand and work effectively in more than one culture. When Megan Burke, the professor at Illinois Wesleyan University, talks about having intercultural understanding, she is saying that it is important to understand both your own culture and the culture of another group. In this case, she thinks it is important for Americans to have greater understanding of Chinese culture.
All right. Thanks so much for being here, Andrew, and thank you for that report.
You're welcome. It was my pleasure, Ashley.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
Welcome to the lesson of the day on the Learning English Podcast. My name is Andrew Smith.
And my name is Jill Robbins. Thanks for joining us. Today's lesson will help you learn more about the English you hear in our video series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C. Here's Anna introducing herself.
Hello. My name is Anna Mateo.
In our previous lesson of the day,
We heard Anna and her friend Bruna talk about hopes and wishes. In today's podcast lesson, we're going to give you more ways to practice using the verb wish.
But first, let's listen to Anna and Bruna again. This is from Lesson 10 of Level 2 of the Let's Learn English series.
Hi, Anna.
Hi, Bruna. What's up?
I thought we could meet for lunch today.
I wish I could, but I can't. I have to research Peru for a story.
How's it going?
Not so good. I've been reading about Peru and listening to Peruvian music. I really want to understand Peru. I hope it's enough.
We wish for things we can't do, have, or be. That means we wish for things that are different from how things are now.
To show this difference, English changes the form of the verb or modal that follows the word wish. For example, can changes to could, have changes to had, is changes to were, was changes to had been, and so on.
So it sounds like this. I wish I could. I wish I had. I wish I were. I wish I had been.
Of course, those are not complete sentences. So now we'll explain how you can practice making sentences with the word wish. First, write or think of a sentence that describes a real situation in the present or in the past. Then use a sentence with wish to express the idea that we want a different situation.
Jill and I are going to give you some examples. First, we say one thing, and then we wish that thing were different. Are you ready, Jill?
Ready.
I can't swim.
I wish I could swim.
I don't understand the question.
I wish I understood the question.
My head hurts.
I wish my head didn't hurt.
Okay, notice that after the word wish, we use a word that sounds like we are talking about the past. But we are not talking about the past. Listen again to this example. I don't understand the question.
I wish I understood the question. The verb understand changes to understood. But we're not talking about the past. In fact, we want to understand the question now. But because wish means that it is not possible at the present time for us to understand, we change the verb to understood. We could also say, I wish I could understand the question.
This change of the verb form also happens in conditional statements, like sentences that start with the word if.
Right. For example, we say, if I had more time, I would study more. The verb had does not mean the past. Instead, it shows a situation that is not real, because it comes after the word if.
Okay. Now, let's give more examples with wish. Are you ready again, Jill?
Ready.
I didn't see the game.
I wish I had seen the game.
He is not here.
I wish he were here.
I smoke cigarettes.
I wish you didn't smoke cigarettes.
They talk really fast.
I wish they didn't talk so fast.
You were not at the party.
I wish you had been at the party.
Notice that for real statements about what people do, we change it to negative when we use wish. They talk really fast.
I wish they didn't talk so fast. In the same way, the negation shown by the word not disappears when we use wish.
I didn't see the game.
I wish I had seen the game.
Now, it's your turn, listeners. We will say a sentence about a real situation and then give you time to say a sentence using the word wish. After, you will hear us say a sentence using the word wish, so you can compare your answer.
Are you ready? Okay, here we go. Sentence number one. I can't visit my family.
I wish I could visit my family.
Sentence number two. I don't have a car.
I wish I had a car.
Sentence number three. He is always late.
I wish he weren't always late.
Sentence number four. They are not here.
I wish they were here.
Sentence number five. I didn't go to the beach.
I wish I had gone to the beach.
Sentence number six. She didn't help me.
I wish she had helped me.
Sentence number seven. She never talks to me.
I wish she would talk to me.
Sentence number eight. I don't know how to swim.
I wish I knew how to swim.
Listeners, how well did you do? Was it easy or difficult to change the sentences and use the word wish?
There are a lot of forms to learn, so don't worry if you could not change all the sentences. But you can always go back and play the examples again, and try to say the sentences with the word wish.
We hope these exercises will be helpful. Now, before we finish, here's a little chant with more examples using the word wish. Ready? Listen.
I can't sing, but I wish I could.
And you don't dance, but I wish you would.
You don't cook, and you don't try.
I wish you would cook, and I wish you would try.
I would if I could, but I don't have the time.
I wish we had a much longer day.
I do too. But what else can we say?
How about this? We wish we had more time with you. We wish we did. You know it's true.
But it looks like time is running out. So one more thing before we go.
We hope you'll write us and let us know something that you wish that we would do to help you learn and have fun too.
Well, we really do have to go now. Write to us and tell us your wishes at learningenglish@voanews.com.
And remember, you can also find us on YouTube and Instagram and Facebook. I'm Jill Robbins.
Thanks for listening. I'm Andrew Smith.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.